everyone, I'm Nitsahone, and it is Friday, so that means it is time for another MTG Top 10. This week, we're going to be looking at the 10 cards from core sets that have had the biggest impact on the game. Core sets are meant to be somewhat simplified sets that can be an effective on-ramp for new players to join the game. As a result of this simplicity, people often think of core sets as being weaker than your usual set, and there may be some truth to that, but that doesn't mean that there aren't tons of super powerful cards that have appeared in core sets as well. The number 10 card on this video, for example, has 62 points, and you know if you've watched a lot of my top 10s, that's a pretty high total for a number 10 on a list. To be eligible for this video, a card had to receive its first printing in a core set. Before Magic 2010, core sets were completely made up of reprints, and while reprints still make up a large portion of the cards in core sets, starting with Magic 2010, they began printing new cards in core sets too. This means that all the cards in this set are from core sets printed after Magic 2010, since the previous ones never had any new cards in them. Also, an important thing to note, I'm not considering Alpha as a core set. I've seen some people categorize it that way, but that's really not what it was, since the whole idea of core sets didn't exist yet. It was just the set at the time. It was the game itself, basically, was Alpha. There are also a few cards I chose to exclude for a few reasons. One of these is Czech lands. It's the obvious number one on the list, and you don't need me to tell you about that. I mean, obviously, lands that produce two colors of mana that are good are going to be number one on a list like this. Also, I didn't include Elvish Mystic because it's a functional reprint of Llanowar Elves, and that seemed kind of boring. And finally, the last one isn't one where I made a decision on, it's just one I was surprised about. Scavenging Ooze, which I assumed would be on this list, was actually first printed in a Commander set, which was kind of surprising to me. I didn't actually realize that, so learn something new every day. So it's not going to be on this list because its first printing was not in a core set. Now, a quick reminder on how I score these lists. Pro Tour, Vintage Championship, and Legacy Championship Top 8s are all worth 2 points, and Grand Prix Top 8s are worth 1 point. Now let's move to number 10. At number 10, we have a card whose printing powered up modern affinity decks, and that is Steel Overseer. Printed in Magic 2011, the Overseer saw a tiny bit of play in standard artifact creature aggro decks built around Tempered Steel. Modern is where it has done the most damage, though, appearing regularly in affinity decks since the format was created in 2011. The Overseer is perfect for the deck because the deck generally looks to go wide with a ton of artifact creatures that get dumped on the battlefield in rapid succession, and this can then pump your whole team, making your board even more threatening. The Overseer has even found its way into some vintage decks, primarily in the artifact-heavy Ravager Shops decks, which use Mishra's Workshop and powerful artifacts to overwhelm the opponent. Just in 2010, the Overseer has 6 Grand Prix Top 8s in Modern, and it could find itself higher up on this list over time. At number 9, we have a card that some argue is the best 2-drop in the game, and that is Young Pyromancer. Originally printed in Magic 2014, the Pyromancer is a control player's dream. As a 2-mana 2-1, it doesn't have the best stats, but the fact that it makes you a creature token every time you cast a spell is absolutely incredible. Decks that run the Pyromancer, which you can find in multiple formats, tend to run incredibly cheap burn spells and cantrips, so the Pyromancer pays those decks off for doing something they were already going to be doing anyway. Despite all that power, it wasn't exactly dominant in Standard, where there weren't as many incredibly cheap instants and sorceries, though it did show up in Boros aggro decks in the format and managed 1 Pro Tour Top 8 and 3 Grand Prix Top 8s. In Modern, the Pyromancer has found itself in spell-heavy decks alongside Delver of Secrets, as well as in Blue-Red Aggro and Blue Moon. More recently, the Pyromancer has gotten more of a spotlight in Modern, as just this year, a deck called Mardu Pyromancer has risen to the top of the tier in Modern, where just a few weeks ago, it won a Grand Prix. The Pyromancer is even stronger in the Eternal formats, where there's an embarrassment of riches when it comes to cheap spells. In those formats, Young Pyromancer appears almost exclusively alongside the aforementioned Delver of Secrets and spell-heavy aggro control decks. Both of the marquee creatures in the decks are easy to play early and allow you to just hang back and leave mana up for the rest of the game, while making your board more imposing. Young Pyromancer has had a pretty great 2018, having already amassed 12 points across both Modern and Legacy, and it may be able to overtake some of the cards that are higher up on this list that aren't seeing as much play these days. At number 8, we have a board sweeper that was a staple while it was in Standard, and that is Tragic Arrogance. All of the other cards on this list at least saw play in more than just Standard. Some of them saw more play in Standard than anywhere else, or a lot more play in Standard than anywhere else. But most of the cards on this list have seen play, a lot of play in multiple formats, and that's what helps them make the list. But that's not the case with Tragic Arrogance. Instead, Tragic Arrogance just saw a huge amount of play while in Standard. During its time there, decks that played a ton of creatures were pretty common, thanks to Collected Company, and Tragic Arrogance was a good way for any deck to thin out the board. Arrogance is great because when you cast it, you get to choose your best of each type of permanent and the worst of each type of permanent for your opponent, so you always come out ahead if you cast this. Mostly control and mid-range decks played this card, card, but many aggressive decks had Tragic Arrogance in the sideboard for use in the mirror. Unfortunately for Tragic Arrogance, it probably isn't going to be on this list much longer, as Steel Overseer and Young Pyromancer are right behind it and still seeing play, while Tragic Arrogance hasn't seen play in over 2 years. At number 7, we have what is arguably the best clone ever printed, and that is Phantasmal Image. Most clones cost a lot more than 2 mana, but not this one. Clones are generally good because they always come into play as the best creature on the battlefield. That's awesome, especially since you are paying 2 mana, and whatever you make this into will almost always cost more than that. Sure, it has the usual illusion downside of being sacrificed if it becomes a target of something, but that's well worth it for something this efficient. It saw a lot of play in Standard, sliding into basically any deck with blue in it. This included Cawblade, some versions of Birthing Pod, Blue-Black Control, and various Delver decks. The image has also seen a fair amount of play in Modern, generally in tribal decks where it can come into play as a creature of the required creature type. In the early days of Modern, that generally meant Merfolk decks where it basically acted as 4 additional Merfolk Lords. More recently, it has begun to see play in the Humans deck that are putting up some amazing finishes in Modern right now. Between 2013 and 2015, it also saw play in Merfolk decks in the Eternal formats. So far in 2018, it has 10 points, and it figures to remain a fixture in Human decks in Modern. At number 6, we have the only Planeswalker to make the list, Jace Vryn's Prodigy, who transforms into Jace Telepath Unbound. Famously a card that almost the entire community underrated, except for Louis Scott Vargas, Jace Vryn's Prodigy quickly proved everyone wrong by being super powerful. People underrated just how quickly he could flip, especially when fetch lands were in Standard, and they also underrated his Planeswalker side. Oh, and by people I'm including myself, as I wasn't overly impressed with him either. Whoops. Sure, his -3 ability makes you still pay the cost for a spell, but so what? You already casted the spell, so you surely have the mana. The gross thing to do was to recast removal, and even worse, board sweepers. Jace was just great in Standard, and powered a lot of blue midrange and control decks, including Esper Dragons, Jeskai midrange, and blue-black control. He has a single Grand Prix top 8 in Modern 2, from way back in 2015 in a Grixis control deck. He hasn't really caught on in that format since then. Jace has also seen play in Legacy, alongside Young Pyromancer in various Delver decks, as well as in some versions of Reanimator, where the looting ability combos super well, and the -3 ability on the Planeswalker side can let you recast an reanimation spell. Jace also saw play in Vintage and Monastery Mentor decks, but unfortunately for Jace, that card has since been restricted and it hasn't really seen play since then. While Jace had a good run and could certainly still put up some numbers, he hasn't had a Grand Prix or Pro Tour Top 8 since 2017, so his position could be in danger going forward. At number 5, we have a 4-mana 4-4 with a whole bunch of text, and that is Obstinate Baloth. Between gaining you life when it comes into play and hating on discard spells, Obstinate Baloth is a great addition to many a green deck. It blocks early aggressive creatures well and gains you life, both things that drive aggro decks crazy. What's more is, it was around in formats where Liliana of the Veil was heavily played, and one of the worst feelings is to use Liliana's -1 ability and have your opponent slam a Baloth on the battlefield for free. It saw some play in Standard, primarily in decks like Valakut Ramp, Birthing Pod, and Scapeshift, all of which really wanted to make the game go long enough for them to combo off, and the Baloth helped them do that. It also saw play in Extended in the last year of the format, finding its way into both Jund and Scapeshift decks. After Extended ended and Modern began, the Baloth had no problem making the transition, especially because the aforementioned Liliana was everywhere. In Modern, it has seen play in a lot of decks that it saw play in other formats, like Jund, Scapeshift, and Birthing Pod. Obstinate Baloth is still seeing a decent amount of play in Modern, having managed 5 more points so far in 2018. At number 4, we have a powerful artifact creature, Hangerback Walker. Printed in our last core set, Magic Origins, Hangerback Walker is powerful for a few reasons. First, it is flexible. Sometimes the right thing to do is play it for 2 mana just as a 1-1, and from there you can pay a single mana per turn to slowly pump it. Second, it replaces itself when it dies, making a Thopter token for each +1/+1 counter on it. That last part is insane, as the Walker can effectively just sit on the table and gain +1/+1 counters until it is big enough to attack or block, and if it dies, you are suddenly dealing with a flying army. Hangerback Walker saw a lot of play in Standard since it was basically always insane card advantage, and it was colorless. This included artifact-heavy decks like Blue-Red and Soul Artifact, but for a while, it was seeing play in just about everything. Jeskai Midrange, Chalesnia Aggro, Blue-Black Control, Mono-Green Ramp, and near the end of its time in Standard, Green-White Tokens. It was just a staple for much of its time in Standard because the card had no real board state where it was bad. In Modern, it has found its way into a few Tron decks who can cast this huge really quickly, and in Vintage, it has seen play alongside Steel Overseer and Ravager Shops decks. In which decks, by the way, it synergizes really well with both the Overseer and Arcbound Ravager, since both can put counters on the Walker. At number 3, we have what is one of my favorite cards ever, and that is Thragta. A 5-mana 5/3 that gains you 5 life and leaves behind a 3/3 beast when it dies is just a monster. Like the Baloth, it is the kind of card that really makes an aggro player bash their head against a wall between the life gain and the ability to block twice with the two bodies. In other matchups, it can just serve as a win condition, beating your opponent to death with those tusks. It saw play in most mid-range and control decks that were playing green, doing the most work in Jund and Bank control. It sees play in Modern too. It used to be a great card for Birthing Pod between the useful Enter the Battlefield ability and Leave the Battlefield ability, but that deck got banned. It was also a nice sideboard option for Bloom Titan, which was another deck that got banned. These days, Thragtusk is seeing play mostly in sideboards of decks like Tron and Scapeshift in Modern, where it is a useful way to buy time for your haymakers. While it is mostly relegated to the sideboard in Modern these days, it is basically a staple there for those Tier 1 decks, having added 12 points to its score, all from Modern, so far in 2018. At number 2, we have a very efficient removal spell, Doomblade. While it didn't only put up points in Standard, it did put up the vast majority of them there. There are just simply better removal spells in non-rotating formats. It was a premier removal spell for Black in its Standard environment, or should I say, environments, because this was reprinted in several other core sets, giving it several years of Standard eligibility, which aided it in putting up 91 points in that format between 2009 and 2014. If your deck had Black in it, you probably had Doomblade in it for all those years. As I said, it has seen a bit of play elsewhere. It had one Pro Tour Top 8 and one Grand Prix Top 8 in Extended, in Dark Depths and Fairies, respectively, and it has one Grand Prix Top 8 in Modern, but it's from way back in 2012, and in a world with Fatal Push, there's no reason we'll ever see this see any play in Modern again. Of all the cards on this list, this one has gone the longest without seeing any play, and it seems unlikely to add to its score anytime soon, unless it gets another reprint. At number 1, we have the only card ever printed in a core set to get banned, and that is Preordain. While it may not seem powerful on the surface of it, Preordain isn't all that far from Brainstorm. I mean, it's not quite that good, but it does give you the ability to see up to 3 cards for a single blue mana. Sure, Serum Visions does something similar, but you scry after the draw and not before it. Preordain simply made blue decks too good, too consistent, and this resulted in it being banned and extended near the end of the format as well as in the nascent Modern format in 2011. It has remained banned in Modern since the format was created, but despite that, it still managed to find itself at number 1 on this list. While it has seen a lot of play across 4 different formats, Standard is still where it put up the most numbers, where it was part of blue-black control decks at first and then found its way into one of the more broken Standard decks ever, Cobblade. Obviously, before it got banned and extended, it was seeing play there too in a variety of decks, including Grixis Control, Fairies, and Scapeshift. Despite the fact that it has to compete with the basically strictly better Brainstorm, it has also managed to find its way into the Eternal formats. In Legacy, it was a nice fit in Storm, where it was a cheap way to increase your Storm count while digging for more gas, and it also was really good in Miracle decks, where it could help you scry a Miracle to the top of your library. More recently, it has been seeing play in Show and Tell, where it can either help you find your Sneak and Show cards, you know, to cheat things into play, or the creatures that you want to cheat into play. It has also seen play in the Storm decks of Vintage, as well as in the various incarnations of Delver decks and Monastery Mentor decks, where it could help you flip your Delver while also digging you into more spells and triggering your creatures with prowess. Alright, that does it for this week's MTG Top 10. I hope you enjoyed the video and that I convinced you that there are actually some pretty great cards from core sets past. It will be interesting to see what cards from Core Set 2019 continue this tradition. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to like it and share it so others can enjoy it too. If you want to make sure you catch future MTG Top 10s, don't forget to subscribe. Thanks for watching.